crashing Willie's garage.
Ha!
Hello, Rondas. Hey, welcome back to Willie's Garage. It is January 20th, Wednesday. We have a new president, George.
Bite wind. I couldn't think of what. How does Alf say something that's positive?
He never really does say anything that's positive. That's why you can't think of anything. But by the way, this is the show where me, a lifelong Alf fan, and George, a newcomer to the series, even though we're the same age, just completely escaped George. We watch every episode, and we're midway through the first season. Actually, we're on the home stretch of the first season. We're on episode, even though this is 15 of Willie's Garage, we're on episode 14 of the series. And we're trying to get Alf to come on the show. We had a hot tip. We had a writer from Alf back in the day come on the show. He said he would try to get word back to Paul Fusco or Alf himself to be on the show, but the trail's gone cold, George.
Well, I'm just hoping that our persistence will pay off as with each episode, more and more people are watching. There's more of a buzz. And right. Those numbers of increased viewers might not be reflected in the number of views in YouTube.
Right.
It's more like the public consciousness. That's what we're...
The groundswell.
Yeah.
I'm always surprised by... I do get a ton of feedback on this show, even though not as many people watch it as VCR Party. I feel like it's a dedicated group. And people missed it when we're gone. They're like, where's Willie's Garage? So we're plowing ahead.
I get down the streets, too.
You do? Yeah.
Yeah.
Speaking of a new president, I've watched ahead on Alf. There's an episode where Alf has a fantasy that he is the president. Mm. And I thought it'd be a fun thing to show to start off this Inauguration Day episode. So here's a little bit of President Alf in a fantasy sequence.
I'm glad to see you haven't lost your boyish sense of humor, Mr. President.
Hey. Why else would I have appointed Judge Reinhold to the Supreme Court?
Alf, the president has a lot of serious problems to deal with.
All right, that's just a little clip. We'll get to the whole thing later, but now, yeah.
Did his predecessor show up for the inauguration?
No, absolutely didn't. No,
it was the Torkelsons, I believe. It was Mom Torkelson.
Yeah, the Torkelsons, that was the previous president.
Right.
I wonder what other presidential fantasy sequences are in 80s sitcoms.
I'll prepare that for a future episode.
So anyway, another sort of furry orange creature in the White House, but Alf was just a fantasy. We were living in that reality for the last 4 years.
Hmm.
Speaking of Alf episodes, and the reason why I've gone ahead is because I spent the weekend capturing a bunch of Alf episodes from a DVD. Oh, my ears are kind of sagging.
We should start the episode over.
Yeah, let's just... Okay, back to square one. And three, two... I recently got in the German box set. Can you read what this says?
yes, I think you can also decode...
I have no idea what this says.
Decomplete Siri.
I have no idea what that is. If any German speakers are out there...
I'm going to have to use Google Translate.
So this is the complete series, and the reason why I got the German ones is because what we discovered with the American ones is they cut out certain scenes. They play the syndicated cuts, which always had to lose 30 seconds, sometimes some memorable jokes. Like seeing Rhonda, for example, was cut out of the American syndicated versions that are on the box set. And these are also in the correct order that they aired, which the American ones weren't. That confused me for a while. So... I captured every single episode, ripped them from these DVDs. So now we have pristine quality, uncut Alf episodes for the rest of Willie's Garage.
And you can use the audio from... So I'm sorry, did the DVD include both the English and German tracks?
It does have the German tracks, yeah, and subtitles. But yeah, it's the default is English. So the only thing about it is that the inserts are all in German. But I've done some rough translation, and I think I could figure it out.
I'll have to get the German version of Hogan's Heroes. I'm guessing there were some edits there as well.
I wonder. That'd be interesting. All right, so I'm excited to get into this next episode, episode 14. Called A Little Bit of Soap. Let's do a Melmac recap. Had you ever heard of the song? We, you know, elf titles are named after song titles, which I guess you wouldn't know in the 80s because they didn't really give the titles to episodes anywhere. It's only after the fact that these have come out. But this one's called A Little Bit of Soap, which is a song I was not familiar with.
Never heard of it.
So in looking into it, it is by a one-hit wonder group called the Jarnells in 1961. So that kind of tells you a little bit about probably what the writers grew up listening to.
Huge Jarnell heads.
Here's a little bit of the song, which we will probably get flagged for. But I think it's worth it.
A little bit of soap will wash away your lipstick on my face. But a little bit of soap.
Okay, that's probably enough.
Yeah, definitely. That was like the leading edge of the castanets craze in pop music. It was a fine song.
Yeah, it's just fine. A little bit of soap will wash away the lipstick, but it won't wash away the pain in my heart. So the reason this episode is called that is because this is about soap operas, which was, I feel like maybe some of these writers had worked in soaps or maybe it was just as sitcom writers, they wanted to look down their noses at soap opera writers. So in this episode, Alf becomes a soap opera writer simply by sending in scripts. I guess he found the address. Does a lot of stuff by mail, Alf does. To his a soap opera that isn't his favorite, but is one that's watched by Kate's mother, played by Anne Mira, who is back for a second episode. She was on last week's episode. They're like, we got her for, you know, a week. Let's shoot three episodes with Anne Mira. She's great. Doesn't have a ton to do here except to be sort of the shrewish foil to Alf, I guess.
Yeah, it's interesting that usually Alf is on his own as being the most caustic, repellent individual, and here he gets to spar with somebody. The dramatic tension is ratcheted up.
Yeah, and her favorite soap opera, which she takes over the TV and watches despite Elf's consternation, is called One World to Hope For. Pretty good fake title. It sounds like a One Life to Live kind of thing. One World to Hope For. And here's a little bit of that soap TV show within a show from episode 14 of Elf.
Butch, I really want you to know how proud we are.
They kind of get the lighting right, don't they?
The soft sort of focus.
The soft focus, the earrings, and
Butch.
Crossfades.
I really want you to know how proud we are of what you did in that farmhouse.
But Mom, that was almost a year ago.
No kidding.
Maybe so, Butch. But when you put down that rake and told us you were our son... It's not a moment we'll soon forget.
The very next day, I conceived Allison.
But I was wrong. It was 2 years ago.
Boring!
Pretty good example of what a boring... They're talking about something that happened. He thought it was a year ago. It's 2 years ago.
It was very weird. I noticed... this is very obscure, but whenever they show a one-shot of a person on a TV, on a TV, it's always way too close up on them.
You're right.
And I noticed that when I watched Network recently, which Howard Beale, like you usually see every once in a while, they'll cut to him on screen and his face is way too close up. So.
Yeah, it's probably because they know they're dealing with a picture within a picture. TVs were only about 14 inches back then, so they didn't have a lot to work with. Network, I don't know what the excuse was for that, but
being awesome.
It was 2 years ago.
Boring.
Give me that back.
What do you see in this thing?
I see love, compassion, warmth, concern for humanity.
Incidentally, when are you leaving?
Okay, so that's a little bit of One World to Hope For. Alf does not like the sitcom, or does not like the soap opera. Let me just start that over. So that's One World to Hope For. Alf does not like the soap opera. Anne Mira is defending it for some reason. And it turns out that Alf thinks the scripts are boring and thinks he could do better. So he turns one in on his own. And it's taken from just conversations and confrontation he hears around the house, specifically how Kate is annoyed by having Dorothy, her mother, hanging out at the house all the time. And yeah, I guess they don't really get into how that works. I think at one point Kate brings up, like, how do you even get the scripts to them? You know, how do you become a writer?
Yeah, do you think that was like in the writer's room and like 10 minutes before they were going to shoot, they're like, somebody asked that and they shoehorned that in?
A lot of things were just kind of brushed under the rug, but they did play some lip service to it. And we get to see the next version of the sitcom where Alf is a writer for the first time. So here's that.
Look, there's Alf's name.
Written by Alf Shumway? You wrote a TV script?
Didn't go by Gordon.
Yes, I wrote it.
What, all you have to do is write a script and they'll put it on the air?
Well, you have to send it in first.
Oh, it's starting.
You look like you want to ask me something.
Well, actually, I do.
So? Go on, ask me.
When are you going to leave already?
Leave? You want me to leave?
No, I want the man in the moon to leave. Yes, I want you to leave. I want you to go home and live with your friend, Crazy Miriam.
Mom, wait. Thanks a hell of a lot.
Worked for me.
Look at this extended.
Yes,
extended.
I wrote that here. After the blow-up between Kate and her mother, there are cuts to Brian and then to Lynn that feature a soft electric piano music.
Yes, and it's just like so many. I just want to point out Brian's shirt here. This is
Bumstead?
Yeah, Bumstead. That's Dagwood.
Yeah.
His last name's Bumstead, so he's eating a sandwich. It's Bumstead University, so Bumstead U, and it has the fake, you know, collar on it for a sweatshirt. And I went looking for the shirt because I'm like, I got to have this Bumstead sweatshirt. And they don't.
Bob Hedges will have it to you by the end of the week.
I know. I just couldn't find it anywhere. It wasn't on Poshmark, wasn't on eBay. So if anybody has any luck tracking down Brian's Bumstead shirt.
Would you, if you get that, will you reenact this scene and give it a disgusted look?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, I'll post that for the world to see. Yeah, I would love to recreate this extended scene where I think they're just trying to kill time before going to commercial. Let's just watch a little bit more of this during the. And I was surprised to hear Kate say hell.
Yeah, yeah. Shocking at 8 o'clock on NBC. Yeah.
Thanks a hell of a lot.
Worked for me.
The tapping of fingers, I mean, had everything.
It was. I feel like the agent said, we have to have more of our clients in this scene.
Yes, exactly. Can't just be Alf and Dorothy the whole episode. Like, got to have our regulars on.
I thought that was a genuinely good twist, a hard left turn where he leveraged their private moments. And it reminded me of the later Simpsons episode when Homer uses his private life with Marge as part of his... when he's teaching a course about a successful marriage, I think it was.
Yes, and then they all want to hear his bedroom secrets and everything.
Yes, right? Nibble on her elbow.
Yeah, that seemed to be used quite a bit. And then there's, of course, Grandpa writing for Itchy and Scratchy. And, you know, like, I feel like...
writers, they're like...
Very unimaginative.
Yeah, it's the same thing with the soap opera thing. It's like, they're sitting there, they have to write something. Their TV's on. A soap opera's on. What's in front of me?
Yeah. Did you ever watch the show Soap, which was about sort of behind the scenes? I never did either, but
I
like the
before
premise.
Our time.
Yeah, I like the premise of it. I've heard that it's actually funny and was one of the first sitcoms to feature a gay character, too.
Right. So. Was that Billy Crystal's character?
Yep. Yeah. And I'm sure it was respectful. I'm sure he played it realistically. Well, Alf has writer's block, though, because this causes turmoil amongst the family, clearly. And so he decides, okay, I'm not going to use eavesdropping to write the scripts. I'm going to try to come up with heartfelt, heartwarming scripts. But you see him at the typewriter in Willie's garage, and he's having trouble. Notice how you can see the reflection off the plastic of the puppet's mouth.
Yeah, that's that. I found that highly disturbing.
Yeah.
And as a writer yourself, have you used this technique?
Oh, yeah, clothespins? Absolutely. Yeah, okay. I did while putting together the outline for today's Willie's Garage.
There is an outline.
Yeah, believe it or not, I do like that they give Alf fun business. Like, there's one time, I think the last episode we watched, where he just had those tongs, those grabber things, and he was making pasta with it, you know? And, like, that'd be kind of fun. Like, we come in with Alf, you know, with crumpled up paper and an empty coffee pot, and he's putting clothespins on to... You know, I just like the business they give Elf to do.
They're trying to give the guy who's working the one hand something to do.
Yes, exactly. All right, so let's watch him.
Elf, are you all right?
Oh, yeah. Everything's fine.
Why do you have those clothespins attached to your head?
It's a form of acupressure. On Melmac, we use it to relieve writer's block.
Still in trouble with the script, eh?
Read it yourself.
Scene one, interior living root. Interior living root.
It's a typo. I mean, give me a break. I've only got 8 fingers.
I'm sorry. Monica enters. She says, good morning. Well, what's wrong with that?
Willie, there's no one else in the room with her. I've got the woman talking to chairs.
All right, so that's he does get through the writer's block, though, and they watched the episode that's supposed to be heartwarming, but the writers couldn't help themselves, the real writers, and they made it confrontational. And but then Alf, this causes more trauma between Kate and her mother, and then Alf makes them read his version, page 18 of his script, and they do, and that makes them realize that they actually, you know, really do love each other, and she can stay as long as she wants. I am confused about why she can't move back in. I guess Dorothy has a roommate named Estelle, and I guess it's revealed that Estelle has family over, so she has to stay another day at the Tanners, and then it turns out that no, she's just annoyed with Estelle, and then at the end it's revealed that no, Estelle asked her to move out because she was bossy and meddlesome. So it's, and I guess she can't find another place to stay until, so she's in one more episode. The next episode we're going to watch, Ann Mira's back again because this off-screen Estelle doesn't want her there. So she has to find a new place.
So what did you think of Alf calling her a Bronx giraffe?
I liked it. I guess it was very specific. It implies that Ann Mira is from New York and that everybody knows that, and that she's tall. I don't know. I didn't get the giraffe part.
I guess it's relative. But she calls him an orange bath mat. But I thought the first time I watched it that she was calling him an orange Batman.
I did too. I had to rewind it 3 times. And then I thought she was calling him an orange Baphomet, the satanic idol. But no, I think it is an orange bath mat, which gave me an idea to make an Alf bath mat. I've made an Alf Christmas tree. I've made an Alf coat. Why not an Alf, a bath mat made out of Alf puppets?
If that doesn't get Paul Fusco on the show, I think,
come on.
Yeah, I mean, you already grew out the Alf beard.
Yeah, I know, I've done everything I can. I also noticed that Alf mentions Howard the Duck as an example of a bad movie at the time, and I don't know that Alf is that much different than, I mean, Howard the Duck was a
financial flop,
but it's sort of the same idea. A creature from outer space.
Wisecracking
has to fit in, you know, in today's modern 80s, you know.
Yeah.
Alf also reveals that he knows the man on the moon. I think Willie says something like, no, the man on the moon told me. And he goes, who, Fred? You know, I know him, and he never calls. So found out, I like when we get a little bit of Melmac detail, even if it's only as a joke.
Right.
Actually knows the man on the moon.
Well, I thought it was commonly used as a trope in 80s series, and I think also in later series that there was the show within a show, which was clearly influenced by the play within a play of Gonzaga and Baptista in Hamlet. Right. I think we can
obviously
agree.
Yeah.
In Alf, we had one one world to hope for.
Yes.
But on Twin Peaks, there was Invitation to Love.
That's right. I forgot about that.
It Never Ends from The Simpsons. Mm-hmm. Veterinarian Hospital on The Muppet Show. And I don't know if you remember this, but The Edge of Wetness on Johnny Carson.
No, I don't remember that. That was a fake soap opera?
Yes. Well, it was what he would be reading this overly dramatic text, and the camera would pan to somebody in the audience. And sometimes the people thought it was funny, but often they picked out like an angry Greatest Generation kind of guy who was furious that he was on camera. And
every bit has been done before. Like Conan did that, you know, where they would go to people in the audience and – or like, yeah, they had, this is the person that that is this, and then it would go to the audience. And Dave Letterman did audience theme songs. And I mean, it's, yeah, I mean, it all comes from Steve Allen, but I don't remember that bit. I do, put in the comments below what other shows within shows that we missed, because I know.
Oh, there are a lot.
And it's a trope. But a good one, I think, because it allows you to comment. I mean, look at the Poochie episode. I know all my examples are from The Simpsons, but it allows you to comment on the own show that you're making, you know?
Right.
All right. Well, shall we get into some Alf crap?
We've got to do it.
All right, this is the part of the show where we talk about the many, many, some would say too many items of Elf merchandise that may have slipped through the cracks, but we're bringing them back to light some 30 years later, because I think they need to be seen. What do you got for us, George?
Well, first I'm going to show you a selection of several things from one company. This was a company called Henry Gordy. And they were a big merchandiser of the cheapest tie-ins for characters. So here are several sets. This is like the Ball and Jack set, which has no relationship to Alf other than the picture of him on there.
Still kind of want it.
The Alf Slate set, again, had nothing to do with it.
Classic Alf chalk. Yeah.
And the Alf Pocket Coloring Kit, again, has nothing to do with Alf. But I know it because when I collected Batman toys, you would see these racks, these spinner racks. Here, this is the Marvel Comics one, with things, you know, things like the Hulk cuffs.
These would also often be at grocery stores as well. So, yes. or like Five and Dimes, yeah.
Right, and I looked them up, and they, I don't know that they're still in business because first they had a recall of these Galaxy Warriors.
Whatever could those have been based on?
I think they were an original series that, you know, nobody had ever talked about space. Mm-hmm. So they were just going for it, but they had lead in them, so they were recalled. the last thing I could find about them was in 2011 when they settled a $1 million lawsuit when three kids choked to death on these soft toy darts.
Oh, well, there's a choking warning on it. I mean,
it was, yeah. And I'm guessing those were separate incidents, but you know, who can be sure?
Yeah. Those do look like child mouth sized and could get lodged.
Delicious.
Well, they did make some great Elf crap though. That's the definition of, I wanted to show off a poster that, I found online years ago, but I thought it was especially relevant that I've had framed. It's up in my bedroom. But this is Vote Mel Machian, Alf for President. And you can see President Alf there. Very much like the opening clip I showed. I don't know if I can roll my chair back. But yeah, Vote Mel Machian, Alf for President. And
are those short sleeves or are they rolled up like Howard Dean?
I think he's kind of the Howard Dean. Those are short. Well, I don't know. What do you think? Supposed to be rolled up as if he's about to get the job done.
Right.
So I think in honor of the new president, we all hope they could be as good as a Mel Machian president. Yes. Right. A salute is the proper thing to do there. Right. What else you got, George?
Well, I'm starting a new feature, and these are Alf cakes. Look at this thing.
Whoa.
This is a 40th birthday cake. I'm pretty sure this is from overseas. Well, I know it's from overseas because I don't know.
Merrick isn't.
Yeah, and then this was by Torsi Stutka. But just the crash spaceship, the
that's like the ship that we fly crash into Willie's garage at the beginning of every episode.
Yes. And I think they just did a bang up job. Over the coming weeks, you're going to see some cakes that are going to blow
the candles off.
Yeah.
Well, last week we talked about, I think that's a great new feature, and having made an elf cake, I think there's can only go up from the cake I made. Well, let's talk about last week. I think I speculated that talked about how Coleco, I think, had the elf licensing, and that they were the same ones behind on some of our other shows. We've showed off like a Q-Bert big wheel that they made. They were sort of, they got the lesser licenses than Big Wheel got, I think. And I was like, I wonder if there's ever an elf big wheel. And so I looked up online. There isn't much information, but check it out. There's an officially licensed elf. I don't know if it was called Big Wheel or Power. I figure it's called Power Cycle or something like that. But that's the only picture. It's kind of pixely, but you can see that.
Oh, you've got to get it.
I know. I have. Well, don't think I didn't set up an eBay alert.
I want to see you on the BQE. That's the local expressway going to and from your home to the Found Footage Festival headquarters.
I would absolutely take it down. It would take me 3 days to get down to Brooklyn. But yeah, I want to know what the images are in the spokes there. You know, it looks like maybe some cartoon elves in there. And then here's a picture. This is just, somebody needs to make a watercolor painting of this. Check it out.
Oh.
This guy got a brand new elf thing. It almost looks like an elf rug there that's on the lawn, but I don't think so. I think it might just be a lion. There's a diaper.
An elf hat?
And yeah, and look at the hat. It's almost like a bootleg elf hat. Maybe it's licensed, but it's got mesh and it looks like elf on a surfboard. Like, why couldn't this have been me? Now, given I was in sixth grade, but look at this.
Yeah, is that outside?
I think that's grass. And okay, they put a blanket down for a picnic or something. Yeah.
For traction, of course.
Yeah. And there's just some crap littered in the lawn. Looks like maybe a cup, a diaper.
Yeah, and he's got very dirty knees.
Yeah, he does. I don't know who this kid is, but the photo was on Google Images. So come forward and let's talk. So there was an elf big wheel, and I found it. All right, George.
Well, of course, let's throw to the song to introduce the next portion of Alf Crap.
Joe Blevins is perhaps too long jingle for, but I'll never get sick of it for a certain feature that you've been doing.
Why did I get me an Alf tattoo? What kind of trauma was I going through? Instead of Papa Smurf or Mr. Magoo, I got an Alf tattoo. Alf tattoo. I have to hide it in job interviews. And now I'm singing the Melmacian blues because of my Alf tattoo.
All right, so this is, I don't know what to say about this. This is an Alf tattoo. I looked it up, and those words mean Burns drugs, and it was at that point that I realized he's holding something very strange.
A lighter?
Is it a lighter?
It looks like a lighter to me.
Yeah, I just don't know what this other, the part just to the left of it is.
I think that's the thing you flick.
Yeah. Okay.
But I'm confused by the penis that looks like it's
yes. I was going to get to that. That I don't think is related.
Okay. Burns but, drugs. Okay.
Yes, and
it's a great likeness of Alf. But
yeah. So I conclude every Alf tattoo segment by asking Nick Pruer, is this you?
This is not me, nor would I get this one. But the thing I always ask is what part of the body is this on? I'm guessing a leg, right?
Yeah, because I can't even tell what it's like. Is his foot on a chair?
Yeah, it looks like it. Yeah.
I don't know.
There's a drip on the chair. Yeah. I have one more piece of Alf crap. Now, there was that sort of bootleg-looking hat in that photo, and that got me thinking, are there any – this is an officially licensed, you know, probably the best hat I'll ever own, the one I want to be buried in, but are there any other Alf hats? And Well, it turns out there was, and I found this one online on Facebook Marketplace. It says, no problem, ALF, but that's not the official ALF logo. There's no Alien Productions on this anywhere. It's just, you know, some generic Speedway one-size-fits-all hat. But I do like it. I mean, look, it almost looks like a colored pencil drawing. I do not think anybody from Paul Fusco's company gave the go-ahead on this hat.
No, it has – I don't know if you remember, they used to graphic designers used to have rub-on letters.
Yes.
They were like what were they called? Presto Magics or something?
Yeah, I loved Presto Magics. Yeah.
It's
the first time I've ever heard your ringtone.
That's yeah.
Is that an alarm or a ringtone?
That was my phone, but I don't know where my phone is. So
Well, I'd like to apologize to all the viewers of Willie's Garage for that. We usually run a very professional operation here.
I'm doing these things to get thrown off the series.
Presto Magics? Yeah, it kind of looks like the most generic ALF yeah. lettering you could find. No problem, he's saying. And I do love this hat. It's almost more rare, I feel like. So I feel like the kid with the ALF big wheel is what I'm trying to say. Wow. All right, plenty more. I'm looking forward to more cakes, George.
I'm looking forward to more cake. I'm looking forward to, if I can find a tattoo of an ALF cake.
Oh, wow. The singularity will happen.
Yes.
Well, next week, weirdly, because over Christmas in December, ALF was preempted. We're trying to kind of be on the same schedule that ALF was in its first season. So we found out they're preempted due to a TV movie that aired on NBC in December. Well, then, you know, in January, they're preempted again next week. For what? We'll talk about that. But point is, we'll be returning the week after next with a Valentine's Day episode where ALF channels the spirit of Anne Mira's dead husband. It's very strange, but you don't want to miss the seance episode of ALF that somehow shoehorns in Valentine's Day. So they're pulling out all the stops in this first season.
A truly haunting episode.
Oh, very good tease. All right. Well, until next time, everybody. This is Nick reminding you, and that's George reminding you to
bite wind.
Come crashing.